This morning we're back in the book of Mark, and as I was looking at this passage of scripture, I just had to admit that I have a competitive spirit. I just do. I mean, when I play checkers with my grandkids, they don't win every time. I feel like it's my job to teach them that unless you get good at the game, you can't win. Especially with the oldest one, I have to beat him multiple times, and then I start teaching him how to make the moves. But he doesn't understand that he's not a good player unless he loses. And so I want to win. And now some people would say, well, but shouldn't you want to play the game for the fun of the game? My response is, winning's fun. It improves the fun of the game when you win. We played a domino game with the biddies and some others here a while back, and I'm going to tell you, I'm not over it yet, because I was the loser all the way across in that time, and it just bothers me, so I'm looking for a rematch. Now, whether you're a player, and I'm thinking more of sports now, whether you're a player or a coach, you know that you have to deal with strategy. There are things, there's timing. When I was coaching Little League, you didn't just run the kids up to bat. You kept up with the time. And if the time was going to run out and you didn't want to have to bat again, you could slow the game down. And some people called it a lot of things. I called it just good strategy. I watched the clock. But there are some things in the games that we know are just wrong. One instance in that is in most any game you play in sports, there's penalty for tripping. We know tripping is wrong, and so it carries a penalty. Well, my brother one time was playing church league basketball. Now, that's a dangerous thing. Church league, anything is dangerous. We play to win. He was playing, and there was a pharmacist in town, and it wasn't Joe Hughes. There was a pharmacist in town who was on the other team. His name was Andy, and Andy was given the task on his team to cover my brother. And throughout the game, it was one elbow after another, a push after another, tripped him. Andy could not draw a penalty. Remember, my brother got the ball, and he's doing a break toward his goal, and Andy just elbows him and trips him, and he just rolls in the floor. Well, and he didn't get a no penalty whistle, nothing. Stopped. They just overlooked it. He stole the ball and took off the other way. My little brother jumped up, kind of shook himself after he'd hit the floor pretty hard, and he took off running to the other end of the court. And just before he got to Andy, he threw one of the best football tackles you've ever seen. Just took him out. Now, guess what? The whistle blew. He got the penalty, but he stood up doing this. All I can tell you is there were no more elbows and no more tripping in that game, because the dude wasn't going to do it again. So, you know, church sports can be tough. They can be competitive. But there's a problem when that type of competitive nature comes into the ministries of the church. Comes inside the day-to-day ministries that we're doing. And I think that's what's taken place as we look at this text today with the disciples. There's that sports mentality, that competitive mentality that has now moved in to the disciples' ranks. Would you stand with me as we read Mark chapter 9, verse 33 through 37? It says, "Then they came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them," and he's speaking of Jesus, "what were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, because on the way they had been arguing with one another about who was the greatest. Sitting down, he called the 12 and said to them, "If anyone wants to be first, he must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a child and had him stand among them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one little child such as this in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but him who sent me." Lord God, we thank you for your word. And Lord, I pray that you would teach us today the lessons that you tried to teach the disciples back then. The same lessons that you have for us today. Thank you that your word is as relevant today as it was then. May we be the church that you've called us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I don't know about you, but over the years I have found probably the biggest tripping hazard I have are my own 2 feet. I mean, it is amazing how many times we can trip ourselves up. We can trip over our own feet. And the disciples proved on this occasion that they were just as capable of doing that as we are. I want you to think about the setting. Think about what we looked at last week and what has just taken place. 3 of the disciples have gone up on top of the mountain with Jesus, this special time, this opportunity to see him all in all of his glory in the transfiguration. What an amazing sight. They then come back down the mountain and they come to where the other disciples are. And Jesus, again, in all of his glory, performs a miracle of casting out a demon. And he does this even in light of the fact that 9 out of the 12 that were there couldn't do it. So they've seen him in his glory on the mountain. They've seen him in his glory and his activity. Think about the fact that he has sent them out already and told them, go and you do these things. You're going to cast out demons. You're going to heal people. You're going to do all these kinds of things. Remember who the disciples were? They were people just like us. They have that kind of competitive spirit in them. And so with all of that going on, it kind of lends to the human side saying, so who's the best? Peter, what can you do? John, how big was your deal? I mean, they had to start comparing the things they had done and their thoughts about how much they meant to the kingdom of God. Well, when Jesus asked them what they were arguing about, the silence became deafening. Have you found in your life that Jesus has a way of asking questions that'll just shut your mouth? I mean, you know, if I say anything, it's going to be wrong. And if I say anything, it will back me into a corner, so it's best just not. I think that's where the disciples were here. He asked a question, and it was one of those kind of rhetorical questions that it was best to leave it alone. First place, they knew he already knew what they had been talking about. And so he starts to address that. As he puts things into proper perspective, he makes a powerful statement here. If you want to be first, you must be last. If you want to be first, you must be last. Now, everything in our lives tells us that that is backwards. I mean, you think of the way we're taught, the way we're brought up, our culture, everything in our lives says that idea doesn't make sense. How often is the prevailing thought, get ahead at any cost? Climb the corporate ladder, climb the ladders in life, and it doesn't matter who you step on, it's worth it to get to the top. Where society basically tells us that you can push people out of the way, you can use people, you can step on people, it doesn't matter because it's all worth it if you get it to the top of the ladder. But Jesus wasn't focused on worldly things. He had a totally different view here. His values were different. He's speaking here of kingdom values where servanthood is the thing. It's not about associating with the right crowd. It's not about fighting for status or being seen by the right people. He says if you want to be first, you'll be last. We've all heard the old saying, it's not what you know, but who you know. Is that a kingdom idea, or is that a world idea? It's not who you know, it's not what you know, it's who you know. Kingdom or world? Be careful, because it's kind of a trick question. You see, from a worldly standpoint, it's a worldly answer, because the idea of if you know the right people, you'll move up the ladder quicker. We even see it played out in ministry and in churches, as we see, if you have the last name, you're going to get opportunities that folks that don't have the right last name won't get. Now, I'm not picking on anybody, but the truth of the matter is, if your name, if your father or your grandfather was a well-known preacher, guess what? All you got to do is have his last name, and your market value goes up. So the world looks at that and says, yeah, it's not what you know, it's who you know. And if you know the right people, and that's why people drop names, that's why they push their way into the crowds and they get to know the right people and the influential people. So maybe if I do this, I can move up. That's a world value. But it's also a kingdom principle. Because see, we can know all the knowledge that there is about the world. We can have all the spiritual knowledge that there is, but if we don't know the right one, we don't even get into the kingdom. If we don't know God through Jesus Christ, there is no entrance into the kingdom. So that's really a kingdom principle also. Do all you want to do, all the kinds of work you want to do, and it gets you nowhere unless you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So it is about who you know. But only Christ is the focus there, not those people in the world. But there's a twist. There's a little twist right there. Because you and I can only know God through humility. And we only know God through brokenness before a holy God. So it's the way we approach him. We don't say, look, I'm a gift to you. And that's kind of what the disciples were acting like. We're just gifts to Jesus. I mean, he couldn't have done any better than us. And sometimes we act that way. But the fact is, we come before him in humility and brokenness, recognizing our sinfulness. Not pointing at other people's sin, not saying theirs is so bad, because ours is as bad as it can get, no matter what it is. Sin is sin. And so we come to him asking forgiveness for our sin, repenting and asking him to forgive us, and then he'll use us in his kingdom. Very different from the world system. Very different. Jesus then does something very strange, and you have to understand the culture back then. He takes a child into the center of the group, and then he picks that child up in his arms. Now, in that culture, in that Jewish culture at that time, children were of little value. Honestly, kind of like women were of little value. So Jesus brings this child into the midst, and he picks him up, and he basically says, whoever welcomes, meaning whoever shows concern for, whoever cares for, whoever shows kindness to, one of these little ones in my name welcomes me and the one who sent me. I can just hear the disciples' minds racing. Yeah, the baby's cute and all that. Cute kid. Dirty, but cute. But how on earth can this kid help me obtain greatness? Remember, that's the topic here. How can this kid, who has very little value in the world, help me gain anything? Here's the principle. Because see, this child has no influence. This child has no power. But the principle is that in the kingdom of God, greatness is found in ministry, not in position. Greatness is found in ministry, not in position. It's not about the title. It's not about whether your title is pastor or associate pastor or minister of this or minister of that. It's not whether it's deacon or teacher or doctor or anything else. It's about ministry. You can have all the initials after your name and some before your name, and it means absolutely nothing in the kingdom of God unless it is about ministry. God has called us to minister to each other and minister to the world, and that's why the principles are so different. He says, here's this child who represents the nobodies of this world. Care for them. Minister to them. Put your focus there. Don't be looking to see who can help you move up. Just do the ministry, and in the end, you will be great. We need to be reminded today not to trip ourselves up, thinking that we're some kind of prize for the kingdom of God. We're some kind of gift to the church that the church can't do without. This next year, we're going to be celebrating 125 years of this church's history. Now, I don't know how long some of you have been here, but I know I've been here almost 10 years. That means for 115 years, this church was doing ministry without me. You plug your number in. They were doing pretty good before we got here. We have what we have today because of what's taken place in the years before. And so when we get to thinking about how important we are, maybe we ought to stop and think that in the overall scheme of things, we've been here a pretty short period of time. God can do anything He wants to do. He chooses to use us, but He's not obligated to use us, and He can get it done without us. Don't trip over your own ego and your own pride and your own arrogance to think that God needs you. You and I are privileged. We ought to be honored to be allowed to be just a part of what He's doing. Don't get the big head. And because of our competitive spirits, it's easy to get. Don't trip over yourself. Secondly, we're not to trip over other ministries. Look at verses 38, begin with verse 38. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he wasn't following us." Now, when I read this, I had to think, don't you know Peter was going, "Go, John! Man, I stick my foot in my mouth all the time, aren't I?" I can just see Peter saying, "I'm glad it's John this time. Tell him." I mean, Peter's normally the one in this position, but now John comes up with this. And see what he's doing? He's not real comfortable with what Jesus is trying to teach them, and so he's diverting. He's pointing to something else. "Lord, I know we missed it here, but look what we did here. Wasn't this good?" Now look at Jesus' response to him. "Don't stop him," Jesus said, "because there's no one who will perform a miracle in my name who can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For whoever is not against us is for us, and whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because of my name, since you belong to the Messiah, I assure you, he will never lose his reward." The disciples were saying here, okay, we can deal with the kid thing, but this guy over here, this person over here, he's doing some things and he's using your name, Lord, and he's not even one of us. Now, we're going to deal with this much more in depth as we start a new series the week after Father's Day. So in the latter part of July, first part of August, we'll be talking about this in more depth. But for right now, let me just say, we need to stop shooting at other churches and other Christian ministries. Folks, it's easy for me as a pastor to get competitive in my nature on this. It's easy for me to say, well, I don't want them to get the blessing. We need the blessing here. I don't want to see that happen there. I want it to see it happen here. And so it's real easy for me to get in that competitive nature. And I think it's probably pretty easy for many of you to do that also. See, here's what I've had to come to. I'm a Christian first. Which means if they're Christians and I'm a Christian, then we're together in something here. I'm a Christian first and foremost because I'm adopted into the family of God. Not by anything I did, but by the fact that God chose me. So I'm a Christian. I'm a Southern Baptist second. by choice. I'm part of the Southern Baptist of Texas Convention, second. Those are both together right there, because by choice. You see, what I understand is that on the national level or the state level, they're not perfect. But I choose to be a part of them because I believe they hold dearly to the biblical truth and principles. If they deviate from that, I'm a Christian. And we'll figure out the rest of the stuff after that. So, but it's real easy for me to say, well, I'm a Southern Baptist, and shoot at those that aren't. I'm an SBTC person. I'm part of the Southern Baptist of Texas Convention, and shoot at those that aren't. But the fact is, we're all in this together. That's one of the things that I have appreciated about our state convention here, is I don't hear a lot about, well, those guys over there, and start talking. Here's what, from the top man down, here's what they'll say. Let them do their ministry. We're going to do our ministry. And we're going to talk about what we believe God wants us to do. And we're going to talk about where God's directing us. And we're not going to worry about all this other stuff. Folks, that's great advice for all of us in our everyday walk. As we look at other ministries, other denominations, we need to just hear that. Because the truth is, one day, if we're believers, we're going to be in heaven. Don't tell anybody, but there's going to be people other than Southern Baptists there. I got news for you. There's going to be some Southern Baptists that aren't going to be there. So, when we get to heaven, we're all going to be one. We're all going to be unified. The labels are all going to be gone. You say, well, Pastor, are you saying that we need to do away with the labels and just all come together? Absolutely not. There's a place for doctrine, and there's a place for all those things, and I'm okay with that. But they're not the enemy. And sometimes we act like they are. We're not to be tripping other ministries. You say, well, I can hear what you're saying here in the book of Mark, and I see what Jesus said here, but what about Matthew's gospel? Because in Matthew chapter 7, verse 22, Jesus says something that seems to contradict this. Jesus said, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name and drive out demons in your name and do many miracles in your name? Then I will announce to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawbreakers. How do you take that passage in Matthew and the passage over here in Mark and deal with the conflict there? Well, can I suggest we bring the two together and we lay them side by side and realize what Jesus is saying? I think what he's saying is, you put the two together, let me just give you the Glen version of this. He's saying, you preach, you minister, you teach, let them preach. Let them minister. Let them teach. And in the end, I'll take care of sorting it all out. Because God's saying, I have a perspective that you don't have. I know their hearts, and I know your heart. And so that's what I'll judge on. Did you hear what Amber said a while ago? She was leading in ministry and not a true believer. Does that mean that people who accepted Christ during that time as she was leading in ministry are not saved? Absolutely not. Can God use a lost person to do ministry sometime? Man, he let a donkey talk. So if he can do that, he can do it any way he wants to. You're doing it in his name. Now, praise God, and I'm thankful that she's come to the place where she knows now that she's a child of God. And she made that decision, that connection between the head and the heart, where she brought it all together and God saved her gloriously. And I believe God will use her more now than ever before. But he'll take the message and he'll use the message. Because it's not Amber's words or Glenn's words or Jonathan's words or David's words. It's the Word of God that makes the difference. That's where the power is. And so Jesus says, don't worry about them. Let them go. I'll sort it out. You worry about you. Let them worry about themselves. Quit fighting amongst the names and the titles and the denominations and the groups. And you say, well, what about those that aren't teaching truth? Folks, we're obligated to call out that out. Part of my job is to say, thus saith the Lord, and here's what's being said over here, and it's not according to the Word of God. But there are some things that just we're not real sure about. We think we're right. And I'm not talking about the basics of the faith. I'm talking about some ways. There are people that get all shook up over whether church has elders or not. You know, you can interpret that more than one way. It's not worth fighting over. Some of my best friends are pastors of churches that don't have the same structure of administration as we have. And you know what? They're doing kingdom work and we're doing kingdom work, and that's all right. I have a good friend that spent four years in India in missions. He wanted to go with the International Mission Board of Southern Baptist Convention. David is a Southern Baptist. But because of the age of his children, the Southern Baptists would not send them as missionaries. And they had a good reason for that. But he and his wife were so convinced that God was calling them to India that they worked with another group, raised their own funding, went to India with their children, have had a successful ministry back in the States now. But he'll tell you, I was still a Southern Baptist. I might not have had the vehicle to ride, but I was still a Southern Baptist. I was still a Christian, and I was working with people who were Southern Baptists and other denominations to bring about the gospel message going to people that needed to hear the gospel. That's what it's about. We need to quit shooting at, quit tripping up other ministries. And then Jesus does here what he's so good at doing. You see, the disciples tried to divert the conversation. He dealt with what they diverted to, and then he brings it right back to where he was. This is something good to remember when you're witnessing to someone and you're having that discussion with somebody, because a lot of times when you're doing that, people will try to divert. Well, what about Revelation? Well, answer their question real quickly and then bring it right back over here, because Revelation is not going to matter if they're not a believer. But throw them the carrot and then come back. And that's what Jesus does. He comes right back. Look at verses chapter 9, verse 42 through 50. But whoever, it's almost like he didn't even stop. But whoever causes the downfall of one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for him to have a heavy millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. And if your hand causes your downfall, cut it off. It's better that you enter life maimed. Now, when he says life here, he's talking about eternal life. He's talking about eternity, because that's real life. This isn't. You know that. It's better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, the unquenched fire where their worm does not die and fire is not quenched. And if your foot causes your downfall, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell, the unquenchable fire where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your eye causes your downfall, gouge it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire, in other words, tested. Salt is good, but if the salt loses its flavor, how can you make it salty? And then he says, have salt among yourselves and be at peace with one another. The term here, these little ones, he's talking much more than this child. This child is just a picture. What he is saying here is those who are immature in the faith, those who are weak in the faith, those new believers, those who are seen as insignificant in the church. He said, be careful. how you deal with them and what you do around them. Because sin, one of the sins, is causing one of these to stumble. So often I hear people say, well, it's my life. The only one it affects is me. Folks, more and more and more, I realize that everything I do affects somebody else. And everything you do affects somebody else. And the frightening thing is, we are surrounded. The great thing is, we're surrounded by people who are new in the faith, who are young in the faith, and who are growing in the faith. But the frightening thing is, we're surrounded by people who are young in the faith. And that raises our level of responsibility. You see, I can off-cuff say something that if you're a mature believer, you wouldn't think twice about it. I wouldn't think twice about it. But someone that's not will go, really, what? And they will start questioning things. And they may choose to go a direction that I would have never advised them to go, but because they overheard me say something, then it led them to think, that's okay. I mean, he's a pastor, so if he said that, it must be okay, right? Jesus uses these three metaphors showing how serious sin is. In his commentary, Brooks writes, "The possession of spiritual life is worth the most costly sacrifice. Whatever endangers spiritual life must be totally removed, even as a surgeon amputates a limb that endangers the life of the rest of the body." As I was studying this again this morning, sitting at my dining table, it came to my mind that passage of Scripture, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 6, maybe 12, where Paul says, well, everything's permissible, but everything's not helpful. Now, he was talking about helpful to himself. Let me tell you, I think it also, it's permissible, but it's not helpful to the body. And there are things that, in the overall scheme of things, if I'm doing it, and it might be okay for me to do it in some way, but if it causes somebody else to stumble, I need to stop. Will it send you to hell? Absolutely not. Will it cause somebody else to stumble and fall in their faith? It could. And so I need to gauge everything I do by that. Instead of getting legalistic and trying to pull scriptures and lay it down, the Bible says this, the Bible, because I've seen the issues that we can all argue scripture all day long and not get there, but the question for me is, if I do this, will it cause somebody else to stumble? And if it will, walk away from it. Walk away from it, it's not worth it. And that's whether they're saved yet or just a new believer. Say, well, what are some of those issues? Well, one of the issues that I think that they had such a huge problem with in the time the Bible was being written, and I believe we still have a huge problem with today in our churches, and that is our words and our actions leading people to think, leading those that are weaker in the faith to think that they can trust in works rather than Christ. Sorry, Amber, but you were up there. Isn't that what we saw with that? If you get baptized, that's work. It's obedience, but it's work. If you get baptized, you go to heaven. If you say this prayer, you'll go to heaven. If you serve on this committee, if you do this, if you attend this, if you do that, we are so filled with doing things that maybe we wouldn't say in most situations that that will get you saved, but we act like it'll keep you saved. Let me tell you, my security and my salvation is in Jesus Christ alone. And my security and my salvation is in Jesus Christ alone. I don't work to maintain my salvation. I work because I'm working for Him and I'm servant. And I want to serve Him. That's what this is about. Be a servant. But it's not to maintain my salvation. It's not to put a mark in. It's not like we have. You remember when... They don't do this anymore, I don't think. We're told now, which I tend to agree with. They don't stick those little stars up. You remember Sunday school? When I was a kid, boy, you got a star for this and a star for that and a star for that. We're teaching them works. You don't get it through works. You get it through the grace of God. Salvation, eternal life, comes from the grace of God through your faith alone. And it's not by anything you can do. And you can't maintain it by works. But we tend to, in the church, we tend to make people think, or at least what they're hearing, is if I do enough, I'll be okay. No. It goes right back to that relationship. And I just believe if we'll get the relationship right, the other things will come. There's many ways we can make people stumble. There are many things we can do that cause others to stumble. Jesus is showing us right here that's serious business. And I have to think about it not only for the church, but I have to think about it for my home. I have to think about it for my neighbors. I have to think about it all the time. See, Christianity is not something you get to clock out at the end of the day. You don't punch the clock when you go to work as a Christian and then punch the clock when you leave. No, you're a Christian 24/7. Sometimes I think the reason that so many preachers' kids and deacons' kids and church leaders' kids walk away from the faith is because they've seen mom and dad punch the clock. In other words, they don't act the same way at home that they act at church. They say one thing at church and they do something else when they're at home. And the weaker ones are watching. And they stumble because of us. I see an overarching theme here, and I think it permeates the entire passage. Think about this. We started with the disciples arguing over who was the greatest. And then we found the disciples arguing whether this man over there was part of them or not. And so Jesus teaches about divisiveness and the fact that anyone who does the work of Christ is a brother or a sister. And that not only goes for those outside, what he's teaching, because it was the disciples amongst themselves, and then it was those that were doing ministry that were not necessarily with that group. And so I think verse 50 is the key to the entire passage. He says, be at peace with one another. Be at peace with one another. John 13:35 says it this way, by this all people will know that you're my disciples if you have love one for another. Now church, hang on. But I am thoroughly convinced that through the years, one of the main issues that have caused Christians and churches to lose our saltiness in this world has been our infighting. We fight over style. We fight over clothing. We fight over music. We fight over our preferences. We fight over what I'll call the lesser doctrines. Is there any wonder that young believers and those that are truly seeking for the answer, the way, truly seeking Christ, looks at the church and all of their struggling with each other and go, if that's the answer, I want no part of it. They are stumbling over us. They are stumbling over our lack of being at peace with one another. That doesn't mean we all have to agree on everything. But it does mean that we need to put the major things major and the minor things minor and lighten up. The greatest need is for people to come to faith in Christ. When he says life there, he's talking eternal life, and he's saying that they're gonna, all of you, all of us are going to spend more time in eternity than we're going to spend here. Doesn't matter how many years you live to be 100. Let me tell you, 100's just not even a good start in eternity. And we're dealing with stuff that doesn't really matter in the eternal consequences of things. C- could we agree today that we've been penalized because of tripping as a church? You say, well, are you talking about this church? I'm talking about all churches. All churches. And it's now time that we become the salt of the earth. Folks, we're living in a time, and we're going to spend a lot of time talking about this later, but we're living in a time that we're going to see persecution in the church like we've never seen before. We better figure out who's on our side and quit fighting each other, because there's not many of us. We better target who the enemy is and realize who our friends are and who those that are in Christ are. It's time to be the salt of the earth. It's time for us to give flavor to this world. It is time for us to make a difference in our world for the cause of Christ. And we can't do it when we're tripping, and we're tripping others. And let me just throw in that heaven's a real place, and hell's a real place. Isn't it interesting that Jesus, three times in this passage, talks about hell being a real place? So for these people that say, well, I'm not sure whether there's a heaven or hell, Jesus is real sure. For those that say, heaven's there, but nobody's going to hell, Jesus doesn't see it that way. And so there is a real place called hell. And there's a real place called heaven. And what we're doing here on this earth as a church, as individual Christians, has eternal consequences. Let's get our eyes on the eternal. And focus on that. Let's quit tripping over our own feet. Let's quit tripping other people. Let's quit causing people to stumble by the things that we choose to disagree on and to fuss about. You say, well, Pastor, are you saying we're all in turmoil? Absolutely not. One of our deacons said in a deacon's meeting recently that he said, I just sense a sense of unity now. That's a great thing. But it's a very fragile thing too. We need to protect that. We need to celebrate that. We need to realize that we have a commission from God to do a work here on this earth that He's allowed us to be a part of. But we need to realize it's His kingdom, and it's His work, and it's not ours.